Our young people are desperately fighting to pursue their dreams. And when the horrors of systemic racism shook our country and our consciences, millions of Americans of every age, every background rose up to march for each other, crying out for justice and progress. This is who we still are. Compassionate, resilient, decent people whose fortunes are bound up with one another. And it is well past time for our leaders to once again reflect our truth. So it is up to us to add our voices and our votes to the chorus of history, echoing heroes like John Lewis, who said, "When you see something that is not right, you must say something. You must do something." That is the truest form of empathy. Not just feeling, but doing. Not just for ourselves or our kids, but for everyone. For all our kids. And if we want to keep the possibility of progress alive in our time, if we want to be able to look our children in the eye after this election, we have got to reassert our place in American history. And we have got to do everything we can to elect my friend Joe Biden as the next president of the United States.
And we should just acknowledge that the former First Lady is one of the most effective speakers in American politics today. I mean, she was reading that from a teleprompter, and the way she speaks is, you know, strong enough to give any politician a run for his or her money. In fact, if I can be so bold, she's a more effective speaker than Vice President Joe Biden is when reading from a teleprompter. But beyond that, we've never heard this country, a former First Lady or current First Lady, speak this starkly about the candidate that she is not supporting. She painted, first of all, a very dystopian picture of the United States. And I know there are a lot of people out there who probably recognize that dystopia right now. But it's just not the kind of thing you hear First Ladies talk about. She talked about white supremacists bearing torches and children being stripped from their families, thrown into cages, pepper spray and tear gas used for a photo op, all stories that we lived through and can remember. But it's not typically the kind of picture that a First Lady is known to make.
What struck me was how much she went for the jugular on Donald Trump, not just in her sort of blanket assessment, poor assessment of him, but she knew where to hit him where it hurts. Talking about the fact that that he lost the national popular vote by nearly 3 million votes. We know that that is something that bothers the president almost as much as anything. And also talking about the fact that he barely won the Electoral College, that he won a margin that averaged just one or two votes per precinct. So she didn't just get to go after him, but she went after him in a way that she really knew would bug him. The other thing that was really striking as a parent is the way that she was trying to reach out to parents about, as Jake was saying, the morality and the character that people try to teach their kids, and how she argued that that completely flies in the face of what they see in the White House, that kids are thinking that parents are just not telling them the truth or lying to them when they explain what is right and wrong. And that is certainly a way that she is trying to reach out to people, especially as she emphasized that she is not somebody who likes politics at all.
Yeah, I mean, you could really hear the frustration in her voice. You could see it in her face. And I think that that's what made this so powerful. You know, one of the things that really struck me was hearing her say something that we've heard her say in her post-presidency life about the power of voting. She was speaking directly to Democrats who she said maybe didn't think that their vote counted in 2016 and decided to stay home. It's a direct reference to these narrow margins in the battleground states that President Trump won by. But it was also really speaking to this moment that we're in right now, in which Democrats are looking around at President Trump's comments on voting, and they're worried that he's not going to accept the results of the election. She said pretty clearly tonight, which I think is really extraordinary, that it has to be a margin of victory for Joe Biden that cannot be ignored. I think that was really striking to hear her say that. It's a nod to this concern that is now becoming more widespread among Democrats about whether or not President Trump is going to actually accept the results of the election if he were to lose.
Truly extraordinary moment. I've covered a lot of Democratic and Republican political conventions. Anderson, I have never heard a First Lady of the United States, a current First Lady or a former First Lady, speak about a sitting president of the United States the way Michelle Obama just did.
Yeah, and David Axelrod, as Jake Tapper was saying, it wasn't based on policy issues, though certainly they would disagree on those. It was really, it was a portrait of the president, of his character and his character failings. His lack of compassion, his lack of attention, his lack of caring and capabilities.
Without question, and also setting up the contrast with Joe Biden, which is such an important part of this week for him. Listen, let me say that I've watched Michelle Obama's evolution as a public figure. She spoke a lot of truths in this speech. I think the truest of all was when she said she hates politics. She doesn't speak like a politician. She doesn't think like a politician. And that's one of the reasons why she's such a powerful communicator. This was not a speech in political terms. This was a moral speech from the standpoint of a mother, of a concerned citizen. And it felt that way. And I've seen it many, many times before. She became a great closer within the Obama campaigns because of that, because she speaks with a moral authority few in politics can summon.
Yeah, Naomi Blinka Henderson, have you heard a speech like this? I mean, certainly from a First Lady, I agree with Wolf, I certainly haven't.
No, there hasn't been a speech like this. And if you think about Michelle Obama, she's somebody who really sort of avoided politics. She said that in her speech. And she really kind of, I think, wanted to reserve her capital, her political capital, in some ways for moments like this. Sometimes she would say she wanted to reserve it to make the best case for her husband. And here you see her tonight using all of her political capital. She's also this kind of pop culture figure who also kind of comes across as your favorite next door neighbor. And so here she was speaking so very plainly, using colloquialisms throughout this speech, and really, I think, speaking from the heart in a way that will connect with so many different Americans, urging folks who might not like Joe Biden, right? He's not perfect, she said at one point, but he's somebody who listens. And I think she also kind of wove in all of the themes from the night about Joe Biden being a good listener, being somebody who is empathetic, and speaking as someone who has seen the presidency up close. And she essentially said, listen, Donald Trump has had enough time, and we know now, Michelle Obama said, that he is not up for this job.
You know, Gloria Berger, 4 years ago, Michelle Obama gave a very well-received speech as well. There were a lot of plaudits, and, you know, obviously the results happened that happened. Does this make much of a difference?
It's hard to say. We'll see who's watching this convention. But I'll tell you, the thing that was so affecting about her was not only that she was emotional and a mother and seemed to be a truth teller, but she'd also been in the White House. And when she started out by saying, you know, you simply cannot fake your way through this job, believe me, I've been there. I understand how complex and compelling the issues are. I understand how difficult these decisions are that this president, that a president has to make. And this president has had enough time and he can't do it. And she moved from that to talking about character and about our children and what our children are seeing now every single day and how families are suffering. And then she did a very, very potent get out the vote message. Put on your walking shoes right now. Vote early, because as she said, they're sending out people to intimidate voters and they're lying about the security of our ballots. And for a former first lady to say they're lying about a current president of the United States is really quite something to behold. And you could see and hear the sadness in her voice in a way and the frustration that she has had over these last few years.